got hit.
Suddenly you're half a gyro into a whole bunch of money. Fantastic. Because it felt as if you were in the Beatles, you know, there was a real mass hysteria.
Everything you've ever thought was true of the rock and roll lifestyle is true. There is drugs galore, there is loose women around there.
Get the big house, get the fast cars, get beautiful women in my life. I'm all right, I've done well, and I was very unhappy. Well, what's that all about?
There's this guy who all the women seem to love. He's a pop star, and here he's being wheeled away. What's taken the rug from underneath him?
You know, it isn't one drink for me. You know, it wasn't just one drug. All I know is I did a lot of it, and it nearly killed me.
Come on with me upstage, to the stage of the Barrowlands, where we played one of our first gigs. And wait. It was like New Year's Eve. This place was heaving, you know, to say the least. This was one of the most poignant gigs, because this was the start of, if you like, many venues to come, be it from Barrowlands to Madison Square Gardens to the Hollywood Bowl to Wembley. You know, we played all over the world. I can always remember, true story, after I finished this gig, I got the number, I can't remember the name of the bus, but I got the bus back home. Hey, rock and roll, right?
Home for Mark McLachlan, as he was known then, was Clydebank.
My granny delivered me, you know, my granny brought me into the world. She delivered a lot of children in the street. There was a real sense of community growing up, you know. I mean, we all stayed in that. We stayed in a tenement block and we stayed in the one room. But hearing music in a house when I was growing up, my mother loved people like Julie London or, you know, the Burt Bacharach and Hal David thing. That'll be forever indebted to her for bringing it to the table because it gave me a great sense of melody. I guess remember hearing stuff like that coming out of our big kerklunk, basic 8-track that we bought from the Barras. It just made me feel good inside. As a matter of fact, I just wanted to move closer and embrace the warmth that was coming out of these speakers. And I think that's what inspired me, because she was never shy of giving me a song. She loved the arts, she loved singing. When will I see you again? Watching the TV scene, Top of the Pops, the first time, black and white television. And I can remember saying, you know, I want some of that. I knew that. Now I do dream of distant places.
When you grow up in a scheme in the west of Scotland, you really do think you'll leave school, you'll go into a factory, or you'll go into a trade. The problem came when it came our year to leave school. There was no jobs in Glasgow. The way I remember is going for the interviews to the local shipyard and place, right? The year before, they took on 200 apprentices. The year I left school, they took on 8. Wishing I was lucky. There was no future. There was no future for us other than the music. It was the only thing we could turn to. Thankfully, the nucleus of the band had begun before we left school.
That nucleus was Tommy and his friend Graham Clark, who was to become the bass player and the main songwriter for Wet Wet Wet. It all stemmed from a chat on the way to Clydebank High School.
I met Graham Clark in the school bus one day, going back. He said, oh, I've got a bass guitar, oh, I've got drums. So we got together. This is us aged 12, 13 years of age. You know, and we start playing these little tunes and stuff. And that was the very beginning of the band. And then Neil joined us. Neil was also at the school, so Neil kind of made his little keyboard and stuff. So there's the three of us. And then the big question, who can sing?
Oh, I remember, you know, I always was a singer. I can always remember singing. I just did.
Clydebank High School, the school we all attended, the playgrounds and stuff where we all hung round and took in the influences musically. Playtime would come in the corner. There's this guy singing soul classics, things I'd never even heard. And you think, nuts. But I never thought anything of it.
I can remember Graham saying to me, you know, that really sounds like the record. Or, God, you can sing. I'm like, do you think so?
Graham remembered the Mark McLachlan from school, right? And we said, well, get him up then, get him up. And he came up to a rehearsal one time, and Graham's mum's house and he opened his voice and this wonderful sound came out. I was living in a world of make-believe
when my friends fell under me. We all had that dream. You know, there wasn't somebody going to go off on a different tangent, you know. We all walked about, you know, we were all singing at my trousers. Well, not quite literally, but, you know, there wasn't a lot of money in the camp.
We're all in a dole because we were basically unemployable, you know. No one would give us a job. You'd get your gyro, and that was it. Kind of very much hand-to-mouth, but always with the same goal. Let's get some great songs and let's see how far we can take us.
We were going to be a successful band. And that's just the way it is. OK, well, no chance of apprenticeship. I'll tell you what, let's be a pop star.
Just along here, number 9 is Graham's house. Graham's mum's house, I should say. And we used to do all the rehearsals in the back room in there. We'd set up and have the drums and the bass and the keyboards in one room, and Marty would be in the other. At the very back corner, there's a little kitchen with a gas cooker, and Marty would be singing to that gas cooker. And that's it. The beginnings. Next.
I can remember my father saying to me, I don't really know, Mark. Don't you think you should get like a normal job or try and get a job? We're just with Clyde Bank, you know, or whatever. Why have you got aspirations to... Why, you know? But why not? I think it's important that you do have that and strive for that and have that fire in your belly. And, you know, my mother, on the other hand, would say, keep on going, you know, here's a couple of quid to see you buying that or whatever. Don't tell your dad.
We rehearsed until we had about 10 songs, and that's where we actually decided to do our first gig, foray into Glasgow. And that's where we met our manager, Elliot.
It was Elliot Davis who got them their first professional gig at the Barrowlands.
There's one thing you can never beat, and that's live entertainment in a live environment. And that's what makes places like the Barrowlands a special venue. I'm going to actually sing a wee song, OK? So here we go, right? So we can always say that I was singing in the Barrowlands again, eh? One flake of snow does not mean it's winter. One ray of light does not mean it's day. The tree may fall, the silence will linger, but I may not see you walk away. There you go.
That making their debut on the Pops, Wet, 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 with the hit single Wishing I Was Lucky.
So there's four guys from the Dole, and then in the space of 6 weeks from the Dole to number 6 in the charts. Now that's an incredible thing. Try and take that in your stride.
I think if we'd been a year later, it wouldn't have come together. A lot of our friends travelled, they went, right, can't get a job in Glasgow, I'm away to Amsterdam, I'm away down to London, which is where Wishing I Was Lucky comes from. And the first line of Wishing I Was Lucky is, you know, living in a world of make-believe, best friend wrote and told me there may be a job in the city. And it's all about all our friends exiting, you know, exit Glasgow, London, here I come.
Wishing I Was Lucky was the first of 26 hits for the band.
The winner is Scotland's Braves, Wet, Wet, Wet!
The biggest bands in the country at the time, and so we decided to do that free concert in Glasgow, and there was tens of thousands of people came.
Live on Glasgow Green, the Pride of Glasgow, Quick, Quick, Quick!
That was 15 years ago when the band staged the largest free concert in Scotland.
I always thought of it as being a bit like a football team. Like, so I'm the goalie, I'm at the back, can I get the ball? And I pass it to Graham, and Graham's got it, and he's... I've got it right. Oh, crossed the nail, and he's going to give it to Marty, and Marty shoots! And Marty scores. And I was like, there's the band.
I remember being on stage and looking out and seeing a sea of faces, you know, and I looked down in the pit, and there was my father. And he's kind of looking at me, and I kind of looking away at the side and seeing all these. I don't think he could. I can get my head around it, but I sort of, God knows what he was thinking.
Thank you, Glasgow! Thank you for making four Scotsman's dream come true!
Suddenly, you're half a gyro, aren't you? A whole bunch of money. Fantastic. I did three, four countries in a day when you think nothing of it. Just jump in the wet jet and go.
And they chartered this DC-10 or something, and they split it into two, all the gear at the back and all of us in the front with these big plush seats. So it was crew and band flying round Southeast Asia for 8 weeks in our own jet. And they painted it all, they'd done all the livery on it, so it said the wet jet in the back. You know I love you, I
always will. And just when they thought it couldn't get any better, it did. There's no beginning, there'll be no end. 'Cause all my love, you can
depend. The success that comes from having a massive hit like Love Is All Around takes you into a completely different side of being in the eye of the public. You know, we've been successful, but that just takes you into a whole different stratosphere.
There's been no escape. It seems everywhere you go, you hear the number one record, Love Is All Around, by Wet, Wet, Wet.
We want to know if you're fed up with the single. Love is all around
me. The single was also number one in 14 other countries around the world. And all the while, the band continued to appeal to mainly young female fans.
Well, never a guy band, that kind of frustrated me. Well, why not? I mean, we're, you know, hairy ass guys, why not? Why not, you know? Because if it was five guys in a bar drinking or whatever, he goes, oh, you had that new NXS album, and you two album, cool. You know, I guess somebody would turn around and say, yeah, that new album. My sister and my mom likes it. As a matter of fact, my wife likes them.
Wet, Wet, Wet seem to have a problem with their own image. The result of these four guys getting together and making music was music that they were never that happy with. It sold a lot of records, but it was never the kind of music that they individually saw themselves making.
Wet, Wet, Wet wanted to be The Clash. We really did. We really wanted to be taken so seriously at our music. But no matter how we tried, everything we recorded and put out had a certain feel to it. A happy feel. Made you feel good, you know, that was it, you know. Lifted people's days, and with that territory comes you're anti-trendy, so all the trendies in the music business like that, Wet, 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 are no good, they don't belong there. Jarvis Cocker being the pinnacle of it all, we're on top of the pops live, he opens a jacket and it says, I hate Wet, Wet, Wet.
The band's confusion over why they were not being taken more seriously, coupled with their increasing lack of privacy, took its toll. Marti in particular struggled with it.
I wasn't happy the way things were panning out. Yesterday. And I kind of was starting to unravel. So far away. And the only way I seemed to be able to deal with that was through drinking drugs. I figured if I was just numb, then, you know, it would be easier for me to do what I had to do instead of maybe stopping it. And, or could I stop it? You know, because it was no longer just four guys in the transit van, it was an industry. My privacy was getting more intruded on. Didn't really like that. So I was pretty unhappy at that time. You know, I really started to drink and drug a hell of a lot then. And it nearly killed me.
Early 1999, and Marti is taken by ambulance from the Conrad Hotel in London. He'd overdosed.
I can't really remember much about it. I just remember being rushed to the hospital. Yeah. Well, that just said, you know, I'd much rather just, you know, not really talk about that. What's there to say, really? You know, I mean, I was messed up, I was full of medication, I was drinking, I was just on the last legs, I was spiralling. You know, I mean, I needed help. And I'd just done too much of everything and was taken to the right place.
I remember reading the Daily Mail or the Sun or whatever it was when there was a picture of him wafer thin and being pushed in a wheelchair into a treatment centre. You know, when I look back at that, I think, my God, how sad. There's this guy who, you know, all the women seem to love. He's a pop star. They sell millions of records, and here he's being wheeled away. What's taken the what's taken the rug from underneath him.
Everything that I seem to have wanted, I had achieved. And more. And I don't want to sound like a whinging person, you know what I mean? Because you've got, what have I got to whinge about? You know, you get the big house, you get the fast cars, you get beautiful women in my life, and, you know, I'm comfortable for the, you know, the rest of my days financially. I'm all right, I've done well, and I was very unhappy. So it was easy out for me, it was just head straight for drink drugs. I was doing massive amounts there. And just isolating a lot more, you know, saying to my loved ones, and, you know, I'm away working, and in fact I wasn't. I was just, you know, going away to binge. It was a very dark time. Horrible.
Did you wake up in the morning and...?
No, I came to in the morning. You don't wake up, you come to. It's a big difference. And I can remember, I always found it very difficult to shave. Because I really couldn't look at my face in the mirror. Like, I didn't like myself.
Marty's personality wasn't the only thing unravelling.
Ego started to get bigger. Marty's confusion certainly didn't help. His descent into drugs didn't help at all, because the band were looking for the lead singer to lead, and in most cases he simply couldn't do that any longer. Then there was the factor about money. For so long there had been an equal divide of the spoils, and then suddenly that was all changed. People started to say, well, I don't think that Tommy should get quite as much because Tommy only plays the drums.
Instead of being us, it became me. Each person saying me, me, me. So some people wanted a little bit more. I'll have a wee bit of this and I'll have a wee bit of that. But I know I'll
be happy. It was put to Tommy that Tommy would take a cut in his publishing. Because he was just a drummer. Which was a horrendous time. You know, and I still feel really deeply angry with myself that made sense at the time. I wasn't thinking straight, you know, he was wronged.
I believed that it should be equal all the way through. I think we survived the length of time we did because of that, and I think it destroyed us when it changed. But that's when I could put my hand up and went, I think I'm out of here.
That was the beginning of the end for Wet, that very day that he decided to leave.
But I thought, the band will continue, there's the three of them, they've still got a great voice and still great songwriter, great producer, so this will be fabulous. And then I got a chap at the door about 7 months later from the newspapers. We've got a story about the darker side of Marti Pellow, and they kind of explained roughly what it was, and I just went, nah, you're joking, no chance of that. Print it, you'll get sued to death.
None of the rest of the guys in the band knew that I was doing any of that, you know? I mean, a very secretive user.
How much was it affecting you as a performer?
Ah, forget it. You know, it was just, there was no fire in my eye. No smile on my face. It was complete robotic. I really didn't want to be around people. You know what? I didn't give a shit. You know, I just wanted my hair on. Shape up at the disco and I think I've got a pull.
I ask her lots of questions as she hangs onto the wall. Chris Difford, formerly of Squeeze, is now Marty's co-manager and lyricist. But first and foremost, he's his friend. They've both faced the same demons.
Marty and I have a common bond insofar as we are addicts. You're born an addict. You know, that's always in the background. You know, whenever I was on tour with Squeeze, the most important thing for me during the day was to make sure that I had enough alcohol and drugs for the evening. That was the thing that I focused on. The fact that we were playing Madison Square Garden that night didn't mean a thing to me. What was more important was that when I got back to the hotel room, my fridge was full, and that I had a drug dealer coming around at 10 o'clock or whatever. Crazy, you know, absolute crazy lifestyle.
I was becoming this textbook pop star and big mansion druggie. You know, I wasn't breaking any new ground here. So a lot had to change. And it was hard, it was difficult. God, it was a humbling experience. I was on the bones of my arse. I was a lovely pasty grey colour, and if I went out in the sun, you could probably see my internal organs. Enough was enough.
In March 1999, Marty started his recovery process. He joined the long list of celebrities who sought treatment at the Priory Clinic in London.
One of the things that had to change was I had to leave Wet, Wet, Wet. You know, it wasn't the same. I was sick and I had to start looking after myself, and I just wasn't prepared to play that game. Well, I couldn't anymore, you know, I really couldn't.
The day Marty left marked the end of Wet, Wet, Wet.
How you doing, Marty?
I'm 5 years clean now, and it's the thing that I'm most proud of in my life, because I've learned so much from that. You know, that to be able to talk about it in this situation, it's still quite raw. You know, because you're asking me just to display myself open and talk about shit that's really real. What's it made me? Well, has it made me a better person? My sobriety certainly has. I feel more focused in what I want to achieve. I'm a little bit more at peace sitting with myself, you know, it's all right. It's just all right, Marty.
Not only does it seem that the old Marty's back, but he's also making every effort to relaunch his career. This time, though, he's on his own, and he appears to like it that way. But the other band members of Wet, Wet, Wet were far from happy with one particular solo move of his.
Marty decided to release the best of Wet, Wet, Wet as sung by Marti Pellow. But it was also very, very disappointing from Graham's point of view, because Graham, as a songwriter, reckoned that Marty had sold the family jewels. And yet he goes back to the, you know, in quotes, bubblegum that the band had produced for so long. That was strange. Marty had long since said that he wanted to move on, make his own music. He wanted to be a singer with real gravitas.
And now Chris Difford is helping Marty to achieve that.
The first line doing a bit, Chris, man. Yeah. Squeeze it down a bit.
Where have you gone, my love? I just thought he was this wee eccentric Englishman, you know. I mean, I've been a huge fan of Squeeze for many years and that. I remember going to see them, and who would have thought that X amount of years, you know, we'd be tight.
Tell me the story, my love. Where did it all begin?
I can't honestly say that I have that many people that I consider to be a friend and all that brings to the table.
Hey! Tremendous shot there, Mr. Dalglish.
Loads of acquaintances and stuff like that.
Oh, you dug in deep. That's a beauty.
Real players in your life are a blessing.
He's got one of them pairs of trousers. You know, the pair of trousers that you get on the James Bond movie. You know, remember? Ah, Mr. Bond, your ball's here. That's what Kenny's got.
Are you having a pot?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Very good, man.
Take four.
I think he's just very careful about who he hangs out with, which is fair enough. He is, after all, you know, a complex creature, and he's very private with it.
Stevie Wonder song "Creeping," by our marvellous guest that's with us now, Marti Pellow.
Oh, hello.
Recently,
hello.
Marty was a guest on Jools Holland's radio show.
Hello. Now, Marty, the other thing about you is, of course, you have recently, and you're going to be in again, Chicago, the musical.
Chicago, yeah.
And had you ever been in a musical before?
No.
I don't care about expensive things, cashmere coats, diamond rings, don't mean a thing. All I care about is love.
Following in the footsteps of Sasha Distel, Marty has starred in nearly 200 performances of Chicago in the West End.
But I went to see Chicago and I thought there was something I could bring to the table. You know, I was thinking to myself, well, you know, singing these great songs surrounded by a bevy of beauties, you know, do I really want to do that, you know? And it was a no-brainer. I just absolutely fell in love with the whole Chicago vibe.
I don't care for any fine attire, Vanderbilts, might admire.
Next month, the musical takes him to Broadway.
My mother always said to me when I first went into Chicago, she said, you're going to go to Broadway on this? And I said, nah. She said, I'm telling you, I can see it coming. And she was right.
Marty's smile, lots of people men in particular find it really difficult to cope with Marty's smile.
It's got a certain cockiness about it, hasn't it?
I think they were cheesed off when they saw him on Top of the Pops for 15, 16 weeks in a row and seeing that grin that he has.
Even when he's smiling at a guy, I'm sure the guy's saying, he's not smiling at me, he's smiling at my girlfriend, really.
It's mainly men, actually, that find it disgusting to look at, you know, whereas it seems like whenever he plays live, the place is just full of women who love that smile.
True story. Marty and I were in a place called Ormskirk, outside Liverpool. We were doing recording down there. The whole band's doing recording, and we went out for a shandy one night. And we're walking back along, and two guys are walking down the street. Again, no record's been released. No one knows who we are. And we go, say, aye, excuse me. As we're walking past them, excuse me. And Marty gave one of his smiles. And these two guys went, right, pushed their girlfriends out of the way and went, right, fight. So they went to try and fight us, and I went to step in, and I got a knife in the back. I actually got a knife in my arm. So I get stabbed because of his smile and Ormskirk.
I don't think Marti Pellow will ever end, because I believe his goal to become a film star, you know, is a realistic goal.
I'd love to pursue the acting and see what comes out of it. You know, it'll become abundantly clear if, you know, my enthusiasm outweighs my talent, but, you know, you never know, you might see me in the big screen. But I think you will.
What role would that be?
Well, I don't know. You know, I really don't know. I really don't know.
What would you like it to be?
A sort of modern-day Danny Kaye. What would I want it to be? Well, that's a loaded question. It's a whole bunch of guys I want to be.
Just yesterday morning, they let me know you were gone.
In 5-10 years, you know, I'd love to be breathing in me no sharp pains and be happy. You know, now if that happiness involves singing and dancing, great. Do I want to have children? Yeah, I would love to know what it's like to bring someone into the world. But just to be at peace in 5 and 10 years' time would be great. Your health and be, you know, and family about you. Ah, a few quid in my pocket.
Down.